Hello students, and welcome to the class of immunology paper 4. Today's topic is organs of the immune system, where we shall be discussing about the secondary lymphoid organ, that is the spleen. So let us start with the location of the spleen. The spleen is placed in the upper left part of the abdomen. It is placed below the rib cage and next to the stomach. The spleen is the largest organ of the lymphatic system and it weighs around 150 grams in an adult. The main function of the spleen is to recycle the old RBCs and store the platelets and WBCs in the spleen. The spleen is covered with a capsule. The capsule has an outermost covering which is a serous membrane called as the peritoneum. The shape of the spleen is like a fist of the human and the size is also the size of a fist. Right? As there is a deep indent in the fist, similarly in the middle portion of the spleen, there is a deep indent that is seen. This indent is referred to as the hilus or the hilum. Through the hilus or the hilum, the blood vessels enter and leave the spleen. There are no lymphatic vessels in the spleen. From inner surface of the hilus, the trabeculae originate. They originate and radiate into the spleen, dividing the spleen into small lobules. In addition to the trabeculae that divide the lobe into lobules, each lobule has the red and the white pulp which is scattered throughout the spleen. That is, the splenic pulp can be divided into two distinct types, the white pulp and the red pulp. The white pulp is made up of typical lymphatic tissue consisting of lymphocytes, plasma cells, macrophages, or other cells that are present in the meshwork of the reticular fibers. Right, this is the area where actually the lymphocytes interact with the antigen and get activated in response to the antigen. The red pulp is basically a typical lymphatic tissue. This red pulp is majorly involved in the destruction of the RBCs, the old and the defective RBCs. So the structure of the spleen is red pulp, where old, damaged and defective RBCs are removed, and the white pulp. In between the red and the white pulp lies the marginal zone. And in the marginal zone, you find a few lymphocytes that may be present. And these lymphocytes are the ones that include the dendritic cells, the macrophages, as well as a few B cells. You see the artery, each lobule has an artery that penetrates inside the lobule, and this artery is surrounded by T lymphocytes. The lymphocytes that surround the artery form a sheath around the artery, and therefore it is referred to as the periarteriolar lymphoid sheath, which is abbreviated as the PALS, that is the PALS, which is rich in T lymphocytes, and a few dendritic and a few B cells are present in the PALS. Towards the periphery of the PALS and the marginal zone, there are a number of primary follicles that are present. These primary follicles are aggregates or irregular clusters of B cells that are present. These are present as primary follicles because there is no antigen challenge that has occurred in the follicles. So in addition to the B cells, a few dendritic cells are also present in the follicles, and these dendritic cells are referred to as the follicular dendritic cells. Artery that brings blood to the spleen empties the blood in the marginal zone, where dendritic cells are present. Within the marginal zone, the dendritic cells, they capture the antigen and express the antigen with class 2 MHC molecules on the surface, which leads to the activation of the T cells that are present in the periarteolar lymphoid sheath, that is the PALS. The activated T helper cells in turn activate the B cells. These activated T and B cells, after a while, migrate to the primary follicles, converting the primary follicles into the secondary follicles. The difference in the primary and the secondary follicle is that the primary follicle contains irregular aggregates of the B cells, but the secondary follicle is a follicle in which all the B cells arrange themselves in concentric circle, leaving a place called as the germinal center at the center of the secondary follicle. So after the antigenic challenge, the primary follicle gets converted into the secondary follicle, and within the secondary follicle, the cells, that is activated B cells, proliferate and differentiate into the memory cells and the plasma cells. And the plasma cells that are formed leave the germinal center and enter into the marginal zone, where they start secreting a large number of antibodies, which are carried by the veins to the heart and circulated throughout the body. So the marginal zone is basically the junction between the white pulp and the red pulp, right, which consists of a network of branched reticular cells in association with the extracellular reticulum. Many arteries open inside the marginal zone. So any antigen that is present in the blood is brought to the spleen through the splenic artery. This blood carrying the antigen is emptied into the marginal zone. The antigen is trapped by the interdigitating dendritic cells that are present in the marginal zone. The dendritic cells, they carry the antigen and express the antigen with class 2 MHC molecule and present the antigen to the T helper cells that are present in the PALS. Lymphocytes that are present in the blood also enter the sinuses in the marginal zone and migrate to the periarteriolar lymphoid sheaths. So the initial activation of the T as well as the B cells occurs in the PALS. The dendritic cells that are present in the PALS have an ability to capture the antigen and present the antigen to the T helper cells with class 2 MHC molecules. The activated T helper cells in turn activate the B cells, and activated T and B cells migrate to the primary follicles in the marginal zone. Upon antigenic challenge, the primary follicles develop into the secondary follicles, which contain the germinal centers. Antigenic challenge is when the activated T helper and the B cells, they reach the primary follicles. These primary follicles get converted into the secondary follicles. The activated B cells are the cells present inside the germinal centers. These activated B lymphocytes are actively dividing B lymphocytes, and therefore they are referred to as the blast cells. The size of the blast cell is larger than the B cell, and these blast cells lack the presence of surface immunoglobulins, and therefore they can be easily distinguished from the non-dividing or the slow dividing cells that are present in the germinal centers. For the germinal centers to arise, it requires around a period of 7 to 10 days after the T helper cells get activated. That is, when a T-dependent antigen, that is a thymus-dependent antigen, activates the T cell, After the activation of the T cell, around 7 to 10 days are required for the formation of the secondary lymphoid follicles with the germinal centers. In the germinal centers, in the first stage, the B cells undergo intense or rapid proliferation, and such cells are the centroblasts. These centroblasts are present in the dark zone of the germinal center. The centroblasts are larger in size, they have expanded cytoplasm, they have diffused chromatin network, and there is absence of the surface immunoglobulins. Later, the centroblast leads to the formation of the centrocytes. Now, the centrocytes can be distinguished from the centroblast because the centrocytes are small in size, they are non-dividing cells, and they express the surface immunoglobulins. These centrocytes usually move from the dark zone to the light zone. When the centrocytes come in the light zone, they come in contact with the antigen that is displayed on the surface of the dendritic cells in the form of the antigen-antibody complexes. This interaction of the centrocyte with antigen-antibody complexes expressed on the dendritic cells is essential because certain differentiation mechanisms in the B cell occurs after the contact with the antigen-antibody complexes. And these events are affinity maturation, the class switching, and the formation of plasma and the memory cells. So, initial contact of the antigen activates the T cells, T cells activate the B cells, and B cells lead to the formation of plasma cells. Right? So, in the dark zone, the centroblasts rapidly divide and increase in numbers. These centroblasts get converted into the centrocytes, and these centrocytes come in contact with the antigen-antibody complexes that are displayed on the surface of the dendritic cells. Now, when this interaction between the centrocytes and the antigen-antibody complexes occurs, it leads to one of the major events in the B cell development, that is the affinity maturation. In the affinity maturation process, the B cells or the centrocytes that express surface immunoglobulins that have affinity towards the antigen that is displayed in the form of antigen-antibody complexes on the dendritic cells are present, such centrocytes are allowed to differentiate either into the memory cells or the plasma cells. Because such plasma cells will lead to the synthesis of antibody that has affinity towards the antigen that has activated the T cell. But if the centrocyte expresses the immunoglobulin that has a low affinity towards the antigen that is displayed in the form of antigen-antibody complexes, then such centrocytes are killed by the process of apoptosis. Right? So, any centrocyte that expresses the antibody, surface antibody, which has a less affinity or no affinity towards the antigen that is displayed on the dendritic cells, are killed by the process of apoptosis. Because if such type of antibodies are secreted in the secretion, they will be of no use to fight against the antigen. And therefore, only the centrocytes that have antibodies which have affinity towards the antigen expressed on the dendritic cells are allowed to differentiate into the plasma cells that secrete the antibody against the antigen. Centrocytes that are killed by the process of apoptosis are removed from the spleen by the macrophages, which engulf and process and degrade the centrocyte. within the spleen, B cells get activated, T cells get activated, and antibodies against the antigen are secreted. In addition to this, in the light zone, the memory cells are also formed. So for the formation of plasma cells and memory cells, and for the class switching, it is necessary that the environment that is present in the light zone should be available for the B cell. But another process that occurs in the B cell is the class switching. Class switching is a process that occurs in the activated B cell, in which the B cell secretes antibodies of different classes. The first antibody that is produced by the B cell against the antigen is always an IgM class of antibody. But in the later stages, this IgM class of antibody is switched to another class of antibody, which may be the IgG class of antibody or the IgA class of antibody, depending upon the nature of the antigen. This process of converting one class of antibody or B cell to produce one class of antibody that is different from the other class of antibody is referred to as the class switching process. For this class switching process, it may occur in the light zone or it may occur outside the light zone. But three important events occur in the B cell once the B cell leaves the dark zone and comes into the light zone. These include the class switching, affinity maturation, and the differentiation into the memory cells and the plasma cells. Now let us see the different functions of the spleen. One of the other functions of the spleen is formation of blood. Now this process of formation of blood usually occurs in the bone marrow, but in the embryonic stage, the spleen functions as the hematopoietic organ. Another function is the degradation or destruction of the old blood cells, that is the RBCs as well as white blood cells that are old, have completed their lifespan or have been damaged, are destroyed by the reticular endothelial cells, that is mainly the macrophages that are present in the spleen. The hemoglobin is released on the lysis or destruction of the RBCs, and this hemoglobin that is released is also broken down in the spleen. From the breakdown of the hemoglobin, bilirubin is formed in the spleen, and this bilirubin passes into the plasma. So the spleen usually filters and removes the old useless cells and also allows the young actively growing cells to pass into the circulation, as well as removes the antigens that are present in the blood. Another important function of the spleen is to store the blood, and therefore the spleen is also referred to as the blood bank of the body. Under anoxic conditions like hemorrhage, severe muscular exercise, or at high altitudes, the spleen has an ability to release around 150 ml of the blood, mainly the erythrocytes, into the circulation. Because when the conditions become anoxic, the spleen contracts and releases the stored blood and supplies oxygen to the different parts of the body. Adrenaline injections that are given at high altitudes or patients suffering from asthma also has the same effect as anoxic conditions have on the spleen. Another function is the metabolism of the pigments. Hemoglobin is broken down into heme and globin. Globin is the protein part of hemoglobin, and so this protein is recycled, while the heme group is the iron containing group, and this heme group is split into iron and the pigment hematodin. This hematodin, which gets converted into the bilirubin in the plasma. The other function is metabolism of the iron. So iron that is released is stored in the splenic pulp cells, right? And gradually these cells, like the monocytes and the cells of the reticular endothelial system, that is the macrophages, they carry the iron from the spleen to the liver for storage, or they carry it to the bone marrow where the iron is used in the process of hematopoiesis. The spleen also has a defensive action because the spleen pulp cells have an ability to interact with certain toxins, like for example the diphtheria toxin. And when the pulp cells react with the diphtheria toxin, this diphtheria toxin is removed from the general circulation. The spleen cells, that is the lymphocytes, also react against the infectious agents, that is the pathogens, and help in the process of fighting against the pathogens. So when reactions are occurring in the spleen may be seen as enlarged structure, and this enlargement of spleen is referred to as the splenomegaly. It happens usually in conditions where there is increased process of phagocytosis by the macrophages, as in the conditions of infection. If there is increased destruction of the erythrocytes, for example, as the condition seen in malaria, or abnormal increase in lymphocyte production as seen in blood cancer, are the conditions where the spleen is enlarged, and the condition is referred to as the splenomegaly. To summarize, the spleen is an important organ involved in cleaning out the blood cells and helping to mount the immune response. Although it is relatively small in size, it carries out a variety of different functions in the body. Nowadays, even if the spleen is removed, the person can carry out the normal activities because we have a large number of iron supplements that can be used, and different mechanisms have been evolved which do not require that the person should have a spleen. So although spleen is an organ that has variety of roles to play, a person can live without the spleen. These are a few of the references that I have used for this lecture. Thank you.